Hi, I'm Vance, and welcome to Repair and Replace. If your refrigerator keeps running or won't shut off, then it could be a faulty cold control or temperature sensor. Alternatively, something could be interfering with the transfer of heat. In this episode, first, we'll learn how it all works. Then we'll do some cleaning. Finally, we'll test each component with a multimeter. This applies to most top freezer, bottom freezer, and side-by-side refrigerators. All refrigerators work in the same basic way. When cooling is needed, the cold control sends power to the cooling circuit. The compressor pushes the refrigerant through the system. In the freezer, heat is extracted by the evaporator coils and is released through the condenser coils behind the refrigerator. This process continues until the set temperature is reached. Anything that reduces the transfer of heat will keep the system from cooling properly. If the evaporator fan doesn't run, then it won't push air over the coils. Additionally, if there's a buildup of ice, then it will also prevent the heat from transferring. A faulty condenser fan won't circulate air, which means less heat is removed. Another problem can be dust and dirt, which can build up and act as an insulator. Alternatively, the cold control can wear down over time. This can cause the refrigerator to stay on longer. For models that have a control board, the thermistor detects the temperature. If the thermistor is faulty, it'll misread the temperature and the system will overcompensate. Using a multimeter, components can be tested for continuity. A continuity test will determine if there's a continuous path for electricity to flow through. Without continuity, the component will not work and will need to be replaced. To begin, you might need a screwdriver or nut driver and a multimeter. You might also need a brush or a vacuum. Keep in mind, there is some variation between models, and not all refrigerators will have the same parts. You can enter your model number on the AMRE Supply website to see a parts breakdown. This can be helpful to show you which parts are in your refrigerator and where they are located. First, slide the refrigerator out from the wall. When there is enough room, unplug the cord to disconnect the power. In some models, you might need to remove the water supply line to gain access to the back. Close the shutoff valve to turn off the water supply. Next, use an adjustable wrench to loosen and remove the supply line. Let any remaining water drain into a plastic container. Now, slide the fridge all the way out, so you have plenty of room to work. On the back of the refrigerator is an access panel. Use a 1/4-inch nut driver to remove the screws. Now simply lift up to remove the panel. To ensure proper airflow, it's best to clean the fan and condenser coils. In most models, you can access the coils through the back. Using a vacuum or brush, clean any dust or dirt from the coils. In some cases, the coils are located under the fridge, so you might need to remove the kick plate. The condenser fan can fail electrically or mechanically. You can test the motor in place, or you can disconnect the wires and remove the fan assembly. This will make it easier to see what you're doing. First, Check if the fan blades spin freely. If it feels restricted or if there's any visible damage, then replace the fan. If you have a C-frame or round motor, then you can still test for continuity. Set your multimeter to the ohms or resistance setting. Now touch the probes to each terminal. Depending on the motor, there should be a resistance reading of around 20 to 4,000 ohms. Now, if there's no resistance and no continuity, then the motor is faulty and should be replaced. Some motors can't be tested this way. If the resistance is more than 1 million ohms, then the motor likely has sealed internal components. This means you won't be able to test the resistance of the motor windings. If you're not sure if it's faulty, then it's still best to replace it. To install a new motor, first remove the fan blades. Now unscrew the motor and remove it. Align the new motor and screw it into place. Now reattach the fan blades. Align the assembly onto the mount. Now tighten the screws. Finally, reconnect the wires. Since the evaporator fins are sharp, it's best to wear cut-resistant gloves. To access the evaporator coils, you'll have to remove the screws to the freezer cover panel. Lift up the mounting tabs and remove the panel. If the fan is mounted to the panel, you might need to disconnect the wire harness. In a side-by-side fridge, the fan will likely be mounted above the evaporator coils. To isolate the fan, disconnect the wires and remove it. If your model has a bottom freezer, then you'll have to remove the door to access the freezer components. You can see how to do this in the video linked below. If the evaporator coils are covered in heavy ice, it'll reduce the heat transfer and the refrigerator will not cool properly. You can see more in the video linked below. If the evaporator fan is not running, then it won't circulate air over the coils. First, check if the fan blades spin freely. If it feels restricted or if there's any visible damage, then replace the fan. If you have a C-frame or round motor, then you can still test for continuity. Set your multimeter to the ohms or resistance setting. Now touch the probes to each terminal. Depending on the motor, there should be a resistance reading of around 20 to 4,000 ohms. Now, if there's no resistance and no continuity, then the motor is faulty and should be replaced. Some motors can't be tested this way. If the resistance is more than 1 million ohms, then the motor likely has sealed internal components. This means you won't be able to test the resistance of the motor windings. If you're not sure if it's faulty, then it's still best to replace it. To install a new motor, you'll have to remove it from the mounting bracket. You can see this in more detail in the video linked below. Some models use a cold control thermostat, which will be near the top of the fridge compartment. These have a physical dial instead of buttons. Remove the screws and lower the control housing. It might be held in by plastic tabs, so don't force it or it might break. In some cases, you can disconnect the wires and remove the entire housing. Depending on the model, you might have to remove the dial first. Now lift up and disconnect the wires. Next, remove the thermostat and the sensing bulb. Set the multimeter to the ohms or resistance setting. With the dial turned to any cold setting, test between both terminals. You should get a continuity reading between 0 and 1 ohm at room temperature. You can test to see if the contacts are stuck closed. Set the thermostat to the warmest setting and place it in a working freezer. After 30 minutes, remove it and test. There should be no continuity and no reading on the multimeter. If it fails the test, then the thermostat is faulty and will need to be replaced. Take the new thermostat and align it into the housing. Next, reconnect the wires. Now push the dial back into place. Align the control housing and reconnect the wire harness. Now tighten the mounting screws. Some models use a sensor and a control board to regulate cooling. The temperature sensor is a heat-sensitive resistor, also known as a thermistor. As the temperature changes, so does the resistance. The control board monitors the resistance to determine the temperature. To test the sensor, it can be helpful to use a resistance chart, which is sometimes printed on the tech sheet. The tech sheet is normally behind the kick plate. It also might be mounted at the back or will be hidden under one of the top hinge covers. In many cases, the sensor can be accessed by removing a small cover. Disconnect the sensor wires and remove it. Now set the multimeter to the ohms or resistance setting. Next, touch the probes to each terminal. At room temperature, we're getting a resistance of 2600 ohms, which is close to the rated value. For accuracy, it's best to take another measurement to compare. Test in a glass of ice water with a temperature of 0 degrees Celsius or 32 degrees Fahrenheit. As the thermistor cools over several minutes, the resistance should now be close to the second value. If either test differs more than 10% from the rated value, or if there is no resistance and no continuity, then the sensor is faulty and should be replaced. Push the sensor into the bracket and reconnect the wires. Align the cover. Now tighten the mounting screw. If you have eliminated all other problems and the refrigerator is still not working properly, then it could be a problem with the control board. The board is often located near the back or in a small box behind the kick plate. First, do a visual inspection of the board. If you see any charred or blackened spots, then it's a good sign that there's a failed component or short circuit in the board. As well, double check that all the wire connectors are secure. A loose connection might prevent components from receiving power. In many cases, it's best to install a new control board. You can see more in the video linked below. If needed, align the freezer panel and tighten the screws. align the back panel onto the mounting tabs. Now tighten the screws. Reconnect the water supply and tighten the connection. Open the shutoff valve. Plug in the cord to reconnect the power. Now slide it back into place. Make sure to leave a couple of inches of space between the refrigerator and the wall. This will allow for proper airflow. Now test the refrigerator to see if it's working properly. If you like this and want to see more tutorials and informational videos, then subscribe to our channel. And if you need help, you can call or visit an AMRE location to talk with our knowledgeable staff. Thanks for watching.